Welcome, everyone. Hey, happy afternoon. I'm so glad that you've decided to join us. We're going to make sure that you'll be inspired over the next hour with all kinds of passion-filled activities around instructional approaches to really help your students be inspired to come and learn every day in your classroom. I'm coming to you from Fairfield, California. Many of you may say, Fairfield? Where's that at? Haven't heard of that. Well, my backyard playground is Napa Valley. So I live 10 miles from Napa in a beautiful location that actually represents southeast Minnesota. I've just moved here 6 months ago, and it's been a wonderful ride. And as part of that, I do have family members that live here in California, and it's so beautiful to escape the long winters in the ice and the cold and the snow, because they just had 10 inches again last weekend. So today, this session is all about you. I want to make sure that your passion bucket is filled with lots of ideas that you can take back to your classroom to implement by Monday morning, to make a Monday morning impact. Some of you have school all year round. Some of you have different breaks during this time. So we're hoping that we'll leverage these new ideas to fill your idea bucket to get your kids really engaged in the learning. So our learning outcomes, as you can see, what we're going to be strategizing on is that we're going to look at what really is a passion community of learners. We'll be also looking at how to discover collaborative team building strategies to get your kids really involved in the process, to build trust, respect, and rapport with their peers. We will also look at and explore learning opportunities for you as an educator to truly ignite that inner passion of students, that they feel valued and trusted, and that they can lead in the classroom. Now, my entire presentation is in the cloud today for you, and so I do have a URL for you that if you'd like to tap into that, and it is at a bit.ly link at Naomi Harm Q, and I'll have that throughout the session, and I have some other things that I'd like to share with you to be active participants in our learning today. But again, this session is about you, so I want to know what truly inspires you to be a passionate educator. Can you give me some background of how and why and what you do every single day to fill your passion bucket to inspire your students? Teacher friends, if you can join me in this back channel chat area, which is a Padlet. And within this Padlet already, you've got lots of great ideas coming in. That's how quick it is, which is absolutely amazing. Passion-driven community of learners is giving me passion for life. Some of you are like, I just love life, right, for being an educator. Some of you are also telling me right away that you want to try to see the people behind the students. I get to know them so you can figure out how they are and how to deliver a more robust curriculum and inspired learning environment. Others of you are sharing ideas. It's all about the kids. Yes, it is all about our students. It's their influence, absolutely. You're passionate about creating safe places for kids. You're interested in about also seeing students achieve. You want them to be successful. You know you can make a difference. Absolutely. And again, this learning environment, why it's so important that you have a critical voice, because what inspires us resonates with our students that we work with every day. If we feel that we're not inspired or we're not excited to come to the classroom, our students can feel and they can feel that tone and see it. So we need to make sure that we have our game on with our kids. So thank you so much for sharing your passion about being an educator. Now, what motivates me is a lot of different things. I've been in education over 20 years. I've been a fourth, fifth grade looping teacher. I've been a technology coordinator for a K-12 district. I have been a technology director for 26 schools in Wisconsin. I've owned my own woman's startup company. And I am also an education strategist on the West Coast. My passion bucket is filled because I get to work with amazing individuals like you every single day, and we strategize of how we can create an amazing teaching and learning environment to empower kids. So because of that, on my trip here again, I always like a quick read. This quick read that I found at the airport this time is called What Motivates Me? Put Your Passions to Work. I loved it because it's such a quick read that I could read it within about 2 hours of my plane ride when I need to go to and from. But what really resonated with me was this visual snapshot. It says, there is a lesson in this story for many in the working world. If we want to be happily engaged in our work and performing at our fullest potential, we've got to look inside ourselves to understand what truly motivates us. We can't rely on what others think we should be doing or be enslaved by preordained notations of chasing money, prestige, or power. All of us host a unique blend of motivators, core drivers, that should guide us in sculpting the work life that's right for us. That's creating a passion-based personal learning environment for us educators, but also for our students. How do we ignite that passion? Well, do we even know what students are truly passionate about? When's the last time that you've actually even asked them? Or have you ever asked them? So let's think about this. We know what millennials are passionate about because they have been our students in our classrooms as our past practice. They're currently in the workforce. They're starting to have their own families. But a lot of our teachers right now are still teaching to the millennial needs, not our new generations of students. Okay, well, we're going to continue to move on because we are teaching a new generation of amazing children because our millennials are now supposed to be in the workforce, right? Well, because of that, as we continue on, we're going to look at Generation Z. These are the students that are born between 1995 and 2010. This is a new type of learner. This particular learner is really focused on being an entrepreneur. They truly believe that they are smarter than the millennials, they're more creative, and they're very hardworking. Yes. The work ethic is coming back. We do have hope, so this is great. But our Generation Z students are very dedicated. They're very entrepreneurial in spirit. They also are very diverse in their types of learning and how they learn. They still have some, they're a little bit reserved in always asking their parents for help. They still want to go back to their peers. They want to trust their peers. But at the same time, their attention spans have even shortened. They're 8 seconds to know if they like something or do not like something, and they turn on a switch or turn it off so quickly. So because of that, our Generation Z demands transparency of how they learn and being part of the larger picture. So again, they want smaller chunks of information, and this is where it's coming from the video clip. They really want snackable, bite-sized chunks of content to consume, to work with, to play with, to tinker, to process, and then apply their knowledge. That 8-second attention span, they're making decisions faster and quicker than we ever could have imagined. And because of that, to retain their attention for us in a classroom is even more difficult for us as teachers. So I've got some tips and tricks to help us with instructional strategies and how we design our new lessons for our Generation Z students. We're also going to be focusing on how do we continue to build that passion community of learners to making sure that students are respectful, responsible, and trustworthy and pulling their weight in these groups because of all of the social media that's coming at them to make good choices to be ethical digital citizens. So no matter what we do as teachers, it's always our focus is to build those strongest relationships still with our children. The face-to-face interactions, the thought-provoking times that we can have deeper conversations with our kids to really know how they learn best, where they learn best, and why they learn best. We need to understand what makes our kids tick and what makes them want to come to the classroom and why do they want to learn. And we need to understand how they are so social and how we can build in social collaboration activities with our kids. So when we look at the bigger picture, this is where the research is coming from now of how to design new constructivist lessons based on with our Generation Z students. As you can see, it's a 4-15-4-15-4 approach. The first thing when they come through that doorway in the morning or through your different classes that you have is to make that social emotional connection with them. Whether it's greeting every student at the door with a fist bump or a high five, or it's that immediate essential hook activity of an intro ticket or a do-now activity to gain meaningful information of where their knowledge base is currently at and what they will be involved with in the next 48 to 60 minutes of that class period. We then allow for new information, but the processing time is much different. We don't sit in lecture anymore, teachers. Any new content of information is between 12 and 15 minutes. Otherwise, the brain processing is taking too long to filter out what is information that is very important, whether just subtopic areas. Then you can continue on with another 4-minute piece of information for more reflective practice. Meaning the kids now have new information, what do I do with it? They don't want to have to wait to the end of the 60 minutes to all of a sudden to tell you what they know. They want to be involved. This is where quick writes, think, pair, shares come into play. Interactive Padlets that we've just done. And to brain share information with a dynamic duo or transformative friend next to them to gain new information. Then we break that chunk out again into 15 minutes. 15 minutes of let's apply what we just know now through 2 or 3 activities that are going to strengthen that knowledge. And then we come back to summarize again in a 4-minute soundbite. These pieces of information can help you with really effective rotation stations even in your classroom instead of just a get and sit. So when we look at our classrooms in general, we need to take the most amazing and energizing attributes of an elementary classroom and we need to flip them into the middle school and the high school classrooms. Our kids need to be active, they need to be moving. So these sound bites and snapshots of learning can easily be delivered in rotation stations or in collaborative grouping in pods with kids at any level. Here are some student-centered instructional strategies that I wanted to share with you, and this is coming out of the Global Digital Citizenship. And what is so amazing with this is that we've got a whole new toolbox of ideas that we can help ourselves as teachers to empower learners in the classroom. These instructional approaches are ways to help kids be more communicative, more collaborative, more honest in their feedback, and own their learning. So here's 12 amazing ideas to help with those sound bites of deliverables. And then I have 16 more strategies for you of thinking of different ways to getting kids to own their learning, being more active in the conversation with a balance of infused as a technology approach. Now, because we're talking about students, we still need to know how you as a teacher learn best, because this new approach of how we would create 4-15-4s, that's a new instructional strategy for us as teachers, because you've been teaching some of you the same way for a long time. Now we need to energize it up and change is hard sometimes. So I'd like to know right now, how, where, and why do you learn best? So I'd like you to go back to the active Padlet. I'd like you to type in that address, and I'd like you to reflect on your learning. And this time, not only reflecting on how, where, and why do you learn best, you'll also see that when you're reflecting that you have a hyperlink that's underneath the reflection bar. You can add a digital artifact to support your reflection. By doing that, if everybody would share a digital reflection with a tangible item that is out on the web, you could have hundreds of new ideas to take back to your classroom tomorrow. So again, if you could go to the bit.ly link, bit.ly/where-do-you-learn-best, and that will take you to our online Padlet. And our learning of how we learn best really should be better than chocolate, and it should be in these snackable bites as well. So I've set up the background as an enticing treat for you this afternoon to get your chocolate fix. So again, bit.ly/where-do-you-learn-best. And when I open up that particular Padlet at this time, again, everybody's with me. Excellent job. And I'm seeing that some of you are coming in and sharing your information. And some of you are still adding more information. Some of you are saying, I learn best in a quiet environment. Some of you say, I need to sit and be in a quiet environment. Some of you are saying, I need to listen to classical music, but I need to have some crunchy and munchy food at my disposal. I totally get that. I'm a snacker too. Love it. Some of you say, I learn best by reading and then discussing the content to verbalize your understanding. Others are saying that you need to process the information, and that is so very true. We all learn in a very similar fashion, but it's our processing skills and our speed and retention of information is what is so very, very different. Okay, excellent. Thank you for sharing your information that you have here. Continue to share, and we'll continue to move on to a few more activities for you. I do have some extras that are built into this. I do a lot of design thinking and learning space design challenges. So what I have here for you is I have a learning space design challenge to think differently of how you can set up your physical space in your classroom to accommodate to Generation Z and get you thinking differently with your staff members and your students of how to redesign a space based on a challenge activity to making sure that everybody has a critical voice and choice in that learning. Now, when we look at the best practices of when it comes to personalizing the student learning experience, we need to look at the whole student. And because of that, there's so many factors that come into this because all of our students are actually learning very differently. But when we did a poll, and the national research is out here to share with you, there's some similarities between teachers and students. And we need to use this valid research to help us to create these new learning spaces and ideas. When you look up here, this is amazing. 78% of our students and 77% of our teachers say, I learn best by doing and creating. Then, by watching, researching, collaborating, listening, reading, and writing. This is amazing. These are Generation Z students compared to our current teachers in the field. What's amazing as well is that 32% of our students still say that I need writing to help me be successful in my learning process. The brain research tells us that 24% of students need the tangibility of a physical pen or a pencil to write down the idea that they've just gained, to process, to apply, and to store that idea from their frontal lobe to be processed to their back quadrant. So please do not get rid of the paper and pencil or the pens. They need the tangibility to physically write to make the learning connections. But not all students do, but 24% do. And according to our national study, 32% are still asking for that type of piece of technology to help them. Now, some other things I'd like to share with you, some great free resources that can help you really meet the needs and individualize and differentiate. I absolutely love Let's Create. And this Let's Create site, which is called Let's Recap, helps you create sound bites for kids. Sound bites based on authentic overarching questions about the main concept or topic that you're teaching in your classroom. You can record a soundbite yourself, or you can just put it in as a typed text, and the students can reflect back on it to record their own video clip to explain their reasoning. This is huge, especially when it comes to reading or comprehension of reading a text. A lot of our times, students can't keep up with the pace with the writing or the typing, but they can reflect verbally to get their information out to share with you their knowledge base. This is a great way to work with staff as well, too, because it's a great way to build a learning community individually with each and every that's part of your staff, or it can be part of a learning community. But this is a great way with students that they feel they have ownership to reflect on their learning. This is an app and a website. Now, this is one of my favorites. Have any of you been using Instagram Stories or Marco Polo? Just a few, not very many. Well, I'm very much a Marco Polo fan. I have a lot of my other teacher friends that are Instagram story fans. And when we talk about social media and how we can catch kids being good, this is one of the ways that we can actually meet the learning needs of the snackable content bites for our children. Now, personally, down at the bottom of the Marco Polo, I use Marco Polo. It's an app, Android-based or iPad-based. But what I love about it is that we have a closed group of my family members. And when I'm not back in Minnesota and Wisconsin, we can communicate and connect. And what's so nice about this is I don't have to be live in real time to see what they're saying. They can record the video clip, and you have unlimited amount of video storage at one time. Where Instagram stories, it's shortened to about 40 seconds. What I like about this, too, is that there's a lot of times I can't connect with our granddaughter that we have. So I will read a story to her, I'll record that, and then she can watch it later on because we're at a different time zone. So she goes to bed earlier before we do in California. But these types of social stories are exactly what students are looking for because they want to be part of the conversation, but they want snackable sound bites. We have teachers in Wisconsin using this for book studies. It is just brilliant, and it's working so well because it's personalized. It's on your time. It's 24/7, and you can keep the conversation going. Some other things that I use that if you haven't used, Google Keep. This is another one that's just better than chocolate. Why I love this now is because it's integrated fully with Google Drive. As you can see, the grocery store list is what keeps me going. So when I'm done here, this is where I need to pick up by tomorrow when I come home. My husband says, you need to also bring some milk, a fresh head of lettuce, a whole grain loaf of bread, and also don't forget the fruit. What I love about the Google Keep is also on my phone, and when it's updated, I get a notification. So it's helping us as a family be more productive. But the beauty of this, I have two different areas here that you can see. My Q relationship building, I built a list for me to be focused on, and then also my Q learning focus areas. Because Q is so large, you can be overwhelmed here. So I created a concentrated focus of what I wanted to do. And I'm very much a checklist person. So I can check that off when I've made those connections and relationships and knowing that, oh, I did meet with that person or I did follow up on that conversation. But the brilliant part of this with our students of Generation Z love these snackable bites too. They want to be responsible for their projects. They want to ensure they got everything turned in. And you can invite collaborators to be part of your checklist. It's just brilliant to actually having ownership in team work with your students or your staff. Now, one of the other things I really love, I'm gonna give you all kinds of chocolate bites today. Do any of you have a rocket book? Girlfriend, we need to connect. I got a girlfriend back there that she's waving at, rocket book. This is amazing. First of all, I am not selling anything here today, and I am not a reseller of any of this. This is just true and tried practices that I use with administrators, school board members, and teachers and students. But why I like Rocketbook is because this is a way to meet the needs of our teachers that love to still write, which I do, but our students that love to write. And the beauty of this Rocketbook is a notebook. I can write, I can annotate, I can draw, and it comes with all kinds of different colored pens that are very, very cost effective. And the Rocketbook itself comes in a size of an 8x10 or an 8x8. So it's about $24 or it's $14 or $16 for the smaller one. But as soon as I have it all filled, I should say, let me back up a minute, as when I'm writing and creating, and at the bottom of the Rocketbook, it's gonna give you some symbols. I can click on which symbol that I want. It's got a QR code in the center, and it can synchronize with which social sharing site I want it to go to. It immediately shares my notes and my information in the cloud. So because of that, if my notebook gets full, which it will, I take my Rocketbook, I put it in the microwave. I take a cup of coffee, like a mug of coffee. Instead of coffee, I put water in it. I put the mug of water on my Rocketbook. And then I microwave it for 3 minutes, and all of my annotations and writings go away, but everything's been stored in the cloud. There's a school in Colorado for their mobile teaching and learning initiative, for their one-to-one. This is their one-to-one mobile teaching and learning. So in addition that they have access to all kinds of other devices, but it is absolutely amazing how this works. So give it a try. See if it works for you, but this could really reach at least 25% more of your students in your classroom that need that tangibility of the writing factor. So as we continue on, I'm going to give you a few more insights of some other things to help you to build that passion-driven community. But before we do, I want you to take just 30 seconds, turn to your neighbor. Of the ideas that we just shared, what's one thing that you could possibly use that you will retain that information and say, I'm going to try this one new approach that Naomi shared with me? And I'm gonna try to put it into practice by next week. So take about 30 seconds, turn to your neighbor, have a brief conversation, and then I'm gonna get you some more ideas. But I want you to process, because we need that 15-minute break right there. Okay, I'm gonna have you come back in as large group at this time. I'm hoping you got a quick share in of how you could use possibly those ideas. The brain research also shows that if we do not reflect on our new learning and put it into practice within 72 hours, there's an 80% chance that you'll never use that learning strategy in your classroom. So it's really important when you learn something new to actually discuss, have a conversation, or physically write it down, and then put it into practice within 72 hours. Otherwise, most likely, you will never use it again. So we have to keep that momentum up to help keep our teachers positive, too. Now, our personal learning pathways and playlist, they have been around for a while, but it's a new spin with all of this amazing technology that we have at our disposal. And it's a great way to create snackable chunks of content that are just savory pieces of information that our kids just love. So because of that, when we look at the bigger picture, it's really a design thinking approach. And good friend Ellen Descher, I wanted to give her credit. This is her graphic and her design of her sketch note. And what I like about the design thinking is that an educational playlist allows students to student lead in their own learning. It allows them to really discover hidden discoveries, but it allows them to be critical of their learning and having a choose their own adventure quest. They can come back and create and find their own solutions from this, but they also can come back and ask others to help them find a better solution and then continue to ideate the new ideas that come about from their learning. Now, many of these ideas that you've probably used already, but SimBlue is a great resource for creating an educational playlist. This one is all on personalized learning for teachers. SimBlue is creating learning pathways for educators around the world, and it's a great way to get kids excited of personal choice to expand thematic units of study, allowing kids to work in groups to differentiate the instruction, even based on Lexell reading levels. But it really can be a concentrated subject-specific focus that if you just want it to be math, you can still do that. But what's nice, it creates a wonderful visual pin board. And the visualization is so important because brain-based research also proves that us as adults and our children and our students that we work with, that we first see a visual image, we interpret and process that visual image 60,000 times faster than text. That is so why we need to have a picture to tell the story. And it's so important of our English language learners that they have the visualization to make meaningful information of the context that they're reading of that complex text. That's why it's so important. Now, other playlists also include many different areas. This used to be Blend Space. This is called TEZ now, TEZ Teach. This is a great way to preload a playlist, and it's an online resource for teachers that you can create really compelling lesson plans that are deliverable, snackable chunks to your students. You can differentiate them between groups, you can level the learning, and then you can offer different snackable bites. So this particular one, it's going to give you a playlist that it starts out with. It's going to embed videos, pictures, sound bites, and then also reflection. So the kids can choose their own path, or the teachers can choose their own path, and still have that reflection component to apply that new understanding. Now, DIY is by far one of my favorites. Again, this is one that I must say, you need to go home and take this to your kids, if you've got grandkids, your own students. But DIY stands for do it yourself. And what's so beautiful about this is that you can choose your own adventure based on a personal passion. These personal passions are going to also resonate with your students, and you're going to find connectivities between your kids in your classroom that you never thought had likenesses or similarities. So at this particular site, I took one little adventure quest out of here. These are broken down into missions. So if I really wanted to be a beekeeper, and I want to know more about how can I be part of the bigger picture to save our honeybees, the beekeeper here allows for you to go through 8 beekeeper challenges from the beginning to an intermediate to an advanced, and allows kids to understand of how their world reflects on how things change with our environment and what causes them to die out based on what we do in our environment. So what's amazing about this is a whole global competency project. So what I like about this as well is that you can also upload your own projects within DIY and create your own. And there's a parent pathway for over the summer or designated time when the kids are off for school that you can see and with which areas your students and which playlists that they've been on to keep kids safe. So it's a great extension activity. Now for us as teachers, I love TED Talks. I watch a TED Talk almost every morning. That's better than waking up with coffee. And I need that rejuvenation to keep me inspired and passionate about what I do. But what I like about TED Talks is that you can create your own playlist, but you can also see what has been generated for you. So this particular one says the love of lifelong learning. Don't you love it? We have a veteran teacher that's there. But I'm a veteran teacher. I've got 20 years in. But when we look at this, these are actual videos to inspire you as a veteran teacher, all the way to a newbie, our brand new teachers that are coming on board. But sharing of best practices to keep us inspired and how to make change in our classroom with our students. Now, the other part that we want to talk about is playlists are great. They can be the game changer for a lot of our kids. But we also need some other tools to help us with creating snackable chunks of content and also deliverables. And students want to be part of the learning process. They want a lead, they want a voice, they want their choice in their learning, and they want it gamified. Q's done a really nice job that they've got Chrome Warrior for this event and that you can gamify your own learning and to actually earn your digital badge through a point system. So that's one way of gamified learning. But what I love about this is where I get geeky. I love the research that supports gamification. I was just in a school last week. The teachers are saying, Naomi, all these kids do is they sit and play games. That's all they do. They're not doing what they're supposed to do. I kind of sat back and I was like, oh, there's lots of things I could have shared at that time. But I pulled out the research card. Teachers got pretty quiet on me. But I said, this is how we need to create a gamified learning environment around the content that's necessary for them to know, but engaging for them to feel the purpose that they own part of the learning and they have an adventure to choose. So my next strategy with that school is that we are going to be making some snackable content chunks of gamified learning with these teachers. They're on board because we have to let them own it too. They even said too, Naomi, are some of our technology sessions we sit in are hours and hours long and I don't get it after 15 minutes. We need to gamify our learning for us as teachers, but make them in small, snackable chunks. The best thing about ways of creating games is there's no wrong way or necessarily a right way. That's the nice thing about this because you have different avenues. This is a great infographic to tell and to give you an overview of how to create gamification in your classroom. You don't have to use technology, but you can. But what's nice about it is that you can actually focus on class achievements when students earn a specific badge over a course of time of a mission that they've done. It really shows that they have mastered that content rather than sitting and writing out a long paper or through a poster board presentation. But it allows kids to have choice and voice in their learning of applications as well, too. You'll have lots of ways that you can create, but I wanted to give you some pointers here. Here's an example. Here's a Google Docs, choose your own adventure story. Has anybody created any of those for your kids? Have any of you had your students create them? If not, even better. That's what we should be doing. But based on content that you can set it up into Google Slides, that you can set up as a Google Choose Your Own Adventure story, and they're basing it on life decisions. This is excellent for career development, but also for character education and PBIS for your students in the classroom. Task card challenges. This is created by teachers for teachers. This is amazing because all of a sudden we've got all these tools coming at us. How are we supposed to know all of this? So these are task card challenges that are created through a thing link that are very interactive with touch sensory. And what I like about it, it gives you a one pager, small snackable chunk. It doesn't give you whole 8 pages. That's what I like about it. How about HyperDocs as tech skill challenges? A lot of you that I've talked to, you said, Naomi, we're deploying a lot of Chromebooks. How do I get my teachers up to speed with knowing the ins and out of the tool of the Chromebook? How do we get past the 101 trainings? What a better way. Here's a HyperDoc challenge. Small, snackable chunks to learn the in and outs of the effectiveness of a Google Chromebook, also with Google Apps for Education. How about personalized learning challenges? Here's another HyperDoc. You want to better to get to know your students on personalized learning? Ask them about an All About Me challenge. Integrate outside resources with it. Have them reflect, have them to create and make and tell their story with their group of students so they can better understand each other and to build empathy in your classroom. Learning menus of choice. Where I came from in Minnesota, we love hot dishes. Does anybody know what a hot dish is? You betcha it is. It's a casserole. And a casserole has many layers, right? We scaffold our learning. It's the same way for a learning menu. That's what I love about it, because there's essential components that kids must know. When you set up a learning menu, you can set up a great menu here that basically the main hot dish is the area that they must understand and earn that concept. But then you want to get them excited. So you set it up that you provide them an appetizer. An appetizer is a snackable piece of content to really entice or whet their appetite. It could be a 2-minute video clip. It could be something with a Get Kahoot or a quizzes to take a formative assessment piece. But then the main hot dish are two areas that they should know and we dive deeper into. But then side dishes and the desserts are options that they can choose subtopics and they choose the final digital product to showcase in small peer groups to get feedback on of how they've mastered the content. But the last part that I want to conclude with as part of this is our global scholars. How can we take what we do well in the classroom of these snackable content bites to meet Generation Z and to build a continued personalized learning environment for our kids? But how can we get this global message out that they feel that they're part of the bigger picture? Because our students want to be part of this bigger picture. So have you ever thought about student-centered job-embedded coaching? I've had lots of conversations with teachers since I've been here, and you say, yeah, our teachers in our TOSAs, we have job-embedded coaching. But why aren't we doing this with students? Our students are so happy to help and co-teach and co-mentor and to help other students that are struggling at times. So we want them to be that pineapple, as you can see here. The pineapple is the welcome. It's the doorway of opportunity to help coach and help others and welcome them into the classroom. This is called a pineapple chart. If you haven't used it, this needs to go in your ultimate game design bag. Pineapple charts are amazing. This provides so much autonomy for K-12 schools right now. Because there's at times that when you're learning something new, you're so afraid to share it with in front of somebody else. Pineapple charts is a system that's set up that if a teacher feels comfortable that he or she is sharing, you can set up a red, yellow, green light system outside of your door. If the green light's on, that means I'm full game. I'm trying this project. I feel comfortable. I feel confident. Come on in during your prep and see how my kids are enjoying this activity. If it's yellow on the outside, that means we're working through some things. I'm not 100%, but come and help me learn. And then the red component means, whoa, we're really struggling. We're not through this activity yet, but come back another time. This allows teachers to come into other teachers' classrooms, even with their students, and learn from them from what they're doing. And that's what we need to do. We need to celebrate more often and help us through our failures and our struggles. But why not set up a pineapple chart for your students? Students showcasing best practices and other students coming in to learn from one another. Or better yet, take it on a global scale. Students have it set up that they have a chart and that you can work with students halfway around the world and different time slots that they can come in that are approved by your teaching staff that they can learn from other students. But just put a spin on these pineapple charts and think about the possibilities for adding more autonomy, adding more freedom of choice, and more collaborations with your students. A few other topics that I've seen here I wanted to add, but the global challenges that our kids want to be a part of, one of the major ones, if you haven't seen, there's a lot of STEM robotics in the Q exhibit hall. What's so amazing about this is that the one that I stopped at as well is called the Wonder Workshop with Dash and Dot. Do you know that they have a whole global robotics competition, just like what Lego does? These are students working with other students halfway around the world. And they've done such a nice job of how to prepare and create coding and programming with kids with all interdisciplinary approaches. We're talking, it's just math and science, it's writing, it's reading, it's career development, it's history. So I was so amazed by this when I saw all the different opportunities that you could do. Another one I just wanted to mention, so the Wonder League Robotics competition, that's coming up soon. So if you haven't challenged your students and staff, try that. How about get your kids involved in a world story exchange? When's the last time you've been part of a global collaboration project? It's a great way to get kids to critically think, problem solve, be part of that bigger picture of using their multimedia of choice and sharing their knowledge out with others. And as you can see, we also have a California school that participated last year in this particular project. It's absolutely amazing. Projects by Jen. If you don't know Jen Wagner from California, everybody needs to just Google her now. She is the most incredible global collaboration project designer that I know. She's a great friend. She's an amazing kinder spirit. She is so passionate about global projects for kids. It's absolutely amazing. And she's got projects here that you can just jump on board with. You don't have to create yourself, but they're already set up for you. I created one this past year, too, called the Global Selfie Stick Project. You're thinking, oh, Naomi, selfie sticks, oh, there's everybody's so vain. Well, let's use Global Selfie Sticks for good. We need to teach and catch our kids being good with technology. So this even comes down to Global Selfie Sticks. This is a great way, and this whole project is building a passion-driven community all year long. And we kicked it off, actually, in August. And I have the learning modules all set up that you can copy, you can use them, and how you can catch kids being good and catch them in learning moments to celebrate the learning that takes place in your classroom. I'd like to end on this note to empower you to try one idea, one learning tool, or one instructional approach to inspire your teaching and learning environment for next week. But ultimately, it's to empower a passion-driven community of learners in your classroom. So thank you, everyone. I appreciate your time, your effort, and dedication to the profession, and enjoy the rest of CUE.